Today's video is sponsored by Ready to Roll. We love D&D, and being able to showcase examples of the best D&D are really what this is all about. And that's why I'm excited to share Ready to Roll with everyone. Ready to Roll is a fast-paced, high-energy tabletop role-playing adventure set in the homebrew high fantasy world of Altero. Watch this for a taste of some awesome, funny, and fantastic Dungeons & Dragons. More, please! Click the link in the description below to start episode 1. And now what you're here for. How my group TPK'd themselves with a counterspell. Hi everyone, All Things D&D is back with two stories about players tragically dying, but learning something along the way. For all you new players, listen to how using counterspell may not always be the best idea. After listening to these two stories, tell us about your epic player deaths. A few years ago, a friend of mine asked if I could DM for him and his roommates who had just discovered crit roll. I hadn't run a table since 3.5, but played more than enough 5th and none of them knew enough to pull anything outside the PHB, so no problem. I decided to run Minds of Phandelver, as it's the best I knew of at the time for teaching people how to RPG. Rather than doing standard character creation, I put together their sheets for them, based on what kind of character they wanted to play. This way I can make sure they don't have any gaping holes, and can min-max their stats for them, thus lowering the chance I accidentally kill them all. I got into tabletop through 40K, and was worried I wouldn't be able to hold back on the wargaming. Everyone had complete control of their backstory and connections, so they got to put their choices into it, and since they didn't really know what all the options were, when I described to the guy wanting to play the tank, his hulking half-orc who goes into blind rages during fights, he seemed happy enough. I pad the campaign out, and fill in a few extra towns, side quests, etc., so I can show them all the different races, and thanks to a no-holds-barred fighting pit in one of them, the different classes as well. They got to hire a ranger to lead them through the forest, fast enough to catch the kidnappers, that sort of thing. They also did the normal newbie RPG stuff, hit the brothel, buy some drugs, and spend a session and a half helping the sorcerer run for mayor of a town that didn't have any structured government, and didn't really want one either. Everyone is having a great time, mostly because the characters they had were 5 of my favorite low-level combos, and were breezing through combat. Combine that with them genuinely being good enough at problem-solving and social encounters that they managed to get through those easy enough. They finish it off after 10 sessions or so, and I ask if they want to keep going or not, and they all said yes. The next week I came in with a few sheets for the NPC mini-bosses and BBEG I planned on using, and enough of a hook to get them to the tower they haven't visited yet. The plan was they would be able to overhear the BBEG giving orders to his minions, and discover all the troubles were just this guy trying to weaken the... you get it. They'd hear what they hear and either he and the other minion teleports away when he's done, or they do so after the party barges in, and they discover the detailed instructions on the corpse of the guy they eventually kill. Should be a pretty good session, and depending on what way it goes down, there are plenty of options for them to move things forward. They had just hit level 5 at the end of the last session, and the sorcerer and wizard were both very excited to try out their brand new level 3 spells. This was my first mistake. I forgot about counterspell. So when they break into the tower, with absolutely no stealth or subtlety, and make it to the right room, I made sure to stop them with a description of the conversation they could overhear. They pick up on my hints, which will be the last time that happens, and stealth up to the door while the rogue slipped inside, and they listened to the whole conversation I had scripted. I was honestly surprised. I figured 20 seconds or so would be as far as I'd get before the party would bust in, but the one right thing I did was make sure I had plenty of filler. When I finally ran out of prepped conversation, I said screw it, and rolled a perception check for BBEG to see if he had heard them literally smashing the front door of the building a few moments earlier, or the fight with the giant spiders in the lower levels. This was my second mistake, 19 plus 5. Yeah, he heard them. Should have just had him teleport away, but I got fancy. So, BBEG wraps up his minion pep talk with a final, oh, and take care of the riffraff skulking in the hall. I then describe him casting teleport with a spell scroll when the sorcerer screams that he kicks down the door and casts counterspell. I have everyone roll initiative and decide to let him waste half his high-level magic trying to counter a level 7 spell as a surprise round. Mistake number 3, I should have just ruled that he wouldn't be able to hear them from the hall. But he looks so happy to be trying his brand new spell, and it's a level 3 versus a level 7. Plus, this screws my friend out of the surprise round sneak attack he was lining up, which would make the fight at least a few rounds. Besides, there's no way he's going to pass the check. Nat 20. I don't cheat as a DM. I don't fudge roles or rules. I fudge narratives and outlines for future sessions. I also feel it's important with new players, especially with non-monster NPCs. They should follow the same rules as characters. There are enough inconsistencies in this game, without adding a bunch more to confuse the noobs. I wanted this final boss to be tough, but doable by level 7 or so, which they should be when they get to him. So I just rolled up a level 8 wizard, hence the spell scroll. The two minions were a level 5 druid, the guy they were supposed to be fighting, and a level 7 warlock. He wasn't even supposed to be there that day, I swear. So I have him scream in frustration, and since he just so happened to come first in initiative, he tells the druid to take them out, walks over to the warlock and casts Dimension Door. Counterspell, and another success. Yeah, another wizard decided to take that one as well. Technically, that was on me, and would be mistake zero, I suppose, but I stand by my advice. I gave my players when picking their spells. That counterspell is one of the level 3s. If you have access to it, you take it. While my players continued to cheer their success, the dice gods were watching, and they were unhappy. What happens next can only be described as a horror show that can only occur when the dice gods are especially vengeful, as that was their last successful roll of the campaign. The druid minion was up next and cast silence to stop that bullcrap, but the damage was done. The rogue and barbarian focused all their attacks on the BBEG, but they missed and he was leaving anyway. The blade lock left with him the next turn, but not before critting the barbarian who forgot to rage and lost half his health. Had really crappy hit dice rolls on HP. The spellcasters were useless and incapable of picking up a hint that a 30-foot sphere of magical silence, centered at this exact point I'm pointing to, means you can step over here and be fine, which was the whole point of this encounter was teaching them positioning. Mistake 4, I know. I should have just ditched the teachable moment, but I needed to get the other two out of there, or it would be an even worse slaughter. The druid on the other side of the room had no problems casting spells and beast forming, and his two trained giant spiders were making short work of everyone else. 5 level 5 human players should absolutely be able to take out a level 5 druid and 2 spiders. I stand by the challenge rating on this encounter. Still, the barbarian dropped first, the cleric didn't bother to prepare any healing that day, the rogue went down next, and the rest were wrapped up in 3 turns. Without those 2 counter spells, barbarian has 20 more HP, the spellcasters have 2 extra fireballs. The only attacks they managed to eventually get off, but only served to wipe out the last of the barbarian's death saves with friendly fire, as well as a surprise round instant crit with sneak attack from the rogue. Like I said, I stand by the challenge rating for this encounter. It sounds like the players still learned something. This next story, a 20th level wizard learns he shouldn't have dueled a clever player. Long story short, I'm DMing a game where the players are magical experiments that were screwed up and got rejected and were scooped up by a benefactor before being recycled for parts. The party is a dwarf artificer, attempt at making a living spell, ended up with a stunted body and a keen aptitude for magic items. Ozimar Paladin, angel forcefully bound in a human body. Human druid, failed brewing of an elixir of life changed her body into a font of spores. Human sorcerer, tried to infuse his soul with technology. And Minotaur Barbarian, bones grafted with druidic Mimir stones, Wolverine style. They do jobs all over the evil empire, on one of which they meet the head of the magical academies, a mage named Felkrin. The paladin had particular beef with Felkrin because he was the one who bound the paladin's angelic spirit into a human body and left him doomed to die as a mortal. As the DM, I had intended for Felkrin to just be an evil asshole and be on his way, but the sorcerer formally challenged him to a duel and rolled very well on his persuasion. Felkrin and the sorcerer are allowed to choose 4 champions and fight 5-on-5. The party calls on their strongest allies, including a literal Abrams tank, and they duke it out in an arena. I won't give a play-by-play of the whole fight, but Felkrin opened by casting Time Stop, then Invulnerability, and a bunch of other buffs before flying up to the sorcerer, who thought he'd be safe in the sky. The sorcerer casts Banishment on Felkrin, who fails his save and is out of the fight temporarily. Below, he can see that Felkrin's champions are way too tough for his allies, so he asks me if he can break concentration on Banishment to cast Polymorph on himself to turn into a sperm whale. We take time to position it right, calculate the weight of a sperm whale, and look up the rules of falling objects. We determine that a male adult sperm whale weighs 41 tons, or just over 90,000 pounds. The sorcerer transforms. Felkrin is unbanished and fails his save to react in time before a sperm whale falls from 100 feet right on top of him. Now the rules for D&D 5e state that falling object damage is 1d6 for every 10 pounds the object weighs, capping out at 20 d6. But I felt this was an appropriate time to waive that rule. Part of being a DM is allowing your players to have their moment, and I was fully on board for this one. The sperm whale splats onto the ground, Felkrin and two of his champions, dealing 9,000 d6 damage to them and himself. We used a dice roller bot and came out with over 31,000 damage. The PCs won the duel, at the cost of the sorcerer's life. His body was too destroyed to revive, so the druid reincarnated him and he came back as a halfling. And that's the story of how dropping a sperm whale on people became my table's equivalent of that time in Star Wars where Laura Dern light-speeded into the bad guy's ship. Sounds like they had a whale of a time. I know, sorry. But dropping a whale on people isn't something I'd probably ever think of doing. Points for creativity. Please let us know what you think and comment below. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel, All Things D&D. Our videos are posted every Tuesday and Friday, so stay tuned for more amazing Dungeons & Dragons content.